Hello everyone, hope you're all safe and fine. So, in our today's lecture, we'll be seeing about deodenum. This can be asked as an essay in your first paper, but the frequently repeated short note is the second part of deodenum. So, let's see everything in detail in this lecture. So, before going to the session, our objectives for today will be an introduction about intestine, shape and location of deodenum, the parts, relations, microscopic structure, interior of the duodenum, duodenal recesses, blood supply, which includes the arterial supply in venous drainage, lymphatics and nerve supply, development, and finally few clinical correlations. So we know we have small and large intestine, okay, and the small intestine will be further divided into three parts, namely the proximal duodenum, middle jejunum and the distal ileal part. So this duodenum is the first, shortest, widest and most fixed part of the small intestine, and this extends from the pylorus, which is the end part of stomach, okay, up to the duodeno-jejunal flexure, where it will continue as jejunum, which you can see in this diagram. It begins from the pylorus, winds, and at this duodeno-jejunal flexure it will continue as the jejunum, and this is the main site of enzymatic digestion of chyme. So, going for the shape and location, duodenum is a C-shaped loop of the small intestine with its concavity enclosing the head of pancreas. Okay, and this will be located in the epigastric and umbilical region of the abdominal cavity. So, what are these regions? We know the abdominal cavity will be divided into 9 quadrants. Right hypochondria, epigastric, left hypochondria, right lumbar, umbilical, left lumbar, right iliac, hypogastric and left iliac region by 4 major planes, namely the Addison's plane and the intertubercular plane and 2 midclavicular planes. Why is this happening? Why is this divided into 9 quadrants? Because we don't have any bony landmarks, as you see ribs and bones in your upper and lower limb. You can't have any bony landmarks to locate the presence of an organ, okay. So we'll just divide them into such superficial quadrants and then mention the location of organs. And so the duodenum will be situated in the epigastric and umbilical region of the abdominal cavity, and this will be opposite to first 3 lumbar vertebrae, which is long here, first, second and third lumbar vertebrae, okay. Hope this was clear. Then going for the parts of the duodenum. So this is a 10 inch long structure, okay, and this is further divided into 4 such parts. First is the superior or the first part, descending or the second part, horizontal or the third part, ascending or the fourth part, okay. So this first part, okay, will just continue from the end of the pylorus and then runs rightwards, backwards and laterally like this, and then curves down to form the superior duodenal flexure. From the superior duodenal flexure, the second part continues and runs along the right margin of the kidney and then reaches up to the lower border of L3 vertebra, where it will curve to form the inferior duodenal flexure. The third or the horizontal part will continue from this inferior duodenal flexure along the lower border of the L3 vertebra, okay, and then runs towards the left across in front of the inferior vena cava and takes a smooth curve upward, okay, and this will continue as the fourth part, which will run immediately to the left of the abdominal aorta up to the upper border of L2 vertebra, okay. So this will be the tracing of locations of the parts, and this here will curve ventrally to form the duodeno-jejunal flexure, and then it will continue as the jejunum. Okay, so let's see the relations and specific features of the duodenum. So if you take the first part, this wholly develops from the foregut. We know the gut tube has foregut, midgut and hindgut, okay, of which the first part will purely develop from the foregut, and this is only partly retroperitoneal, which means most of the part of the duodenum will be confined to the posterior abdominal wall behind the peritoneum, okay, and so they are called retroperitoneal, but this part will be on, will be still having its connection with the mesentery, okay, and it will be only partly retroperitoneal, okay. And then this is freely mobile and distensible part, and one of the common sites for duodenal ulceration. This is because this first part directly continues from the end of stomach, and thereby the acidic chyme will first reach this part, and hence they are prone to ulceration. And then they lack circular folds in the initial 2.5 cm. So the entire duodenum, if you take, they have circular folds called the valves of Kekri, okay. But this initial 2.5 cm will lack such folds, and they'll appear as duodenal cap in your barium meal radiographs. And then they'll be supplied by the celiac trunk branches, which is the artery to the foregut. So going for the relations of the first part. So if you see the anterolation, you have two main structures. One is the quadrate lobe of liver over here, and the gallbladder over here, okay. And posteriorly you have three main structures. One is the portal vein, which you see over here. Gastroduodenal artery is a branch from common hepatic artery of the celiac trunk, okay, just lying behind here. And then you have the bile duct. So these are the posterior relations of the first part. And superiorly you have epibloic foramen. This epibloic foramen is a vertical slit through which the greater and lesser sacs communicate, okay. And then inferiorly you have the head and neck of pancreas as here, okay. So this was about the relations of the first part. Going for the second part, you have some specific features. One, they'll develop from both foregut and midgut, which is the upper half develops from the foregut and lower half develops from the midgut, and they lie behind the transverse colon. And this is this part which receives main structures like the bile duct, chief and axillary pancreatic ducts, okay. Those contents will of the duct will pour into the second part of duodenum, and that thereby facilitates the enzymatic digestion of the chyme, okay. And then it is the only part will be supplied by double dose of Acerecta. As I already mentioned, this derives from both foregut and midgut, right. So this will be supplied by both the arteries which supply the foregut and midgut, namely the celiac trunk of the foregut and superior mesenteric artery of the midgut, okay. And they'll give in branches, namely the anterior and posterior pancreaticoduodenal arcades, okay, which will form double rows of Vasarecta and supply this duodenum. We'll be seeing this clearly during the arterial supply, okay. So let's see the relations of the second part. Anteriorly, this will be related to the gallbladder, here the right lobe of liver, transverse colon, transverse mesocolon, which is the mesentery attached to the transverse colon, and finally coils of small intestine. And posteriorly you have the right kidney, right renal vessels, right edge of inferior vena cava, and the right psoas major muscle. Immediately you will have the head of pancreas. As I said, the loop will hold the head of pancreas, right. So immediately it will be related to the head of pancreas. And laterally from below upward, you will have ascending colon, right colic flexure, and right lobe of liver. Okay, so this is the relation about the second part. Getting to the third part, anteriorly, you have superior mesenteric vessels, mainly superior mesenteric artery and vein, root of mesentery, and coils of jejunum. This root of mesentery is nothing but the area along which the mesentery is attached to the posterior abdominal wall, okay, and that traces the root of mesentery. Posteriorly, you have the right psoas major muscle, right ureter, right gonadal vessels, inferior vena cava, abdominal aorta, and inferior mesenteric artery. Also, superiorly, you have the head of pancreas with its uncinate process, and inferiorly, you have coils of jejunum, okay. So let's see about the fourth part. Fourth part anteriorly is related to the transverse colon and transverse mesocolon, okay. And posteriorly you have the left sympathetic chain, inferior mesenteric vein, left gonadal vessels, and left psoas major muscle. Also superiorly you have the body of pancreas related to this. On the right you have the upper part of root of mesentery, and to the left you will have the left kidney and ureter. Okay, so what is this picture showing you? Something called the suspensory ligament of Treitz. Okay, so this is a fibromuscular band which extends from the duodenojejunal flexure. As I said, the fourth part, you see, will continue as jejunum, right? And that curve is called the duodenojejunal flexure. So this ligament will extend from the right crest of diaphragm to the duodenojejunal flexure. So why is it present? What is its significance? One is, this ligament will prevent the dragging down of the duodenojejunal flexure by the weight of the loops of intestine. And the other one is that this will serve as an important landmark, okay, in radiological diagnosis in case of incomplete or malrotation of the small intestine, which means, you know, along with the stomach, the duodenum will rotate and takes the C-shaped loop like this. Okay, so in case of any incomplete or malrotation, you can radiologically diagnose through the position of this suspensory ligament of Treitz. Okay, so this is a word about this ligament. Yeah, let's then see about the microscopic structure in detail. You know, as any basic structure in the GIT, you have four layers. One is the mucosa, submucosa, muscularis externa, and serosa adventitia, from inside to outside. Okay, and here the mucosa of the duodenum will have four main features. One is the plica circularis, which is otherwise called the valves of Kekri. So these are permanent circular folds which have a core of submucosa in them. Okay, and they are present to increase the surface area of the intestine. Is this present throughout the duodenum? See, these are the folds over here. So as we already saw, the circular folds will be absent in the initial few centimeters, okay, of the first part of duodenum, and that was called the duodenal cap. So except this region, the entire duodenum will be having this circular fold called the plica circularis. Then we have villi just here. So these villi are the finger-like projections of the lamina propria, and their core contains the lacteals and the blood vessels. Okay, and this also helps to increase the surface area of the intestine. And then the epithelium of the villi will be lined by simple columnar cells. Okay, and these cells along the luminal surface will have striated appearance, and they are called the microvilli. Okay, and then you have crypts of Leberkuhn, which are nothing but the intestinal glands, the lamina propria, which extends up to the mucosa. Okay, so these are the main features of the mucosal layer of the duodenum. Then you have submucosa, which contains mainly the connective tissue, and they have Brunner's glands. These Brunner glands are highly branched tubulo-acinar mucus secreting glands. Okay, and their ducts will pass through the mucosa and open into the base of villi. So what is the function of this gland? What does it secrete? So if you see here, these are the Brunner's glands present all over the submucosal layer. So these glands secrete mucus, which will protect the duodenum from the acidic contents from the stomach. Okay, then you have muscularis externa layer, which is a layer containing two different muscles, which is the inner circular and the outer longitudinal muscles. Okay, so it's a bilayer of smooth muscles. And then finally, you have the serosa or adventitia as the outermost layer. So if it is covered by connective tissue, it's called adventitia. And if it's covered by peritoneum, it's called serosa. So if you take duodenum, most of the part will be covered by connective tissue and is called the adventitia. And in some part, it will be covered by peritoneum, which is called the serosa layer. Okay, so this was about the microscopic structure. So then, let's see about the interior of the duodenum. So you have main structures, features like the major duodenal papillae, minor duodenal papillae, plica longitudinalis, and arch of plica semicircularis, mainly in the second part of the interior of the duodenum. Okay. So what is this major duodenal papillae? This major duodenal papillae is like a conical projection, which will be found along the posteromedial wall. Should be found along the posteromedial wall of the duodenum. Okay, and this will lie nearly 8 to 10 centimeter distal to the pyloric end of the stomach. Okay, So this is the major diurnal papillae, and it is through this summit in which the main ducts, namely the pancreatic ducts and the bile duct, open into. So this is the opening passage for the common hepatopancreatic duct, which is formed by the union of the bile duct and the main pancreatic duct. Then you have the minor diurnal papillae, which will lie some 2 cm proximal to this major diurnal papillae, and into this summit only the axillary pancreatic duct will open into the duodenum. And then you have plica longitudinalis, which is vertical fold, which extends from the major diurnal papillae. And then arch of plica semicircularis, which is the hood-like structure of the mucous membrane, which is lying over the major diurnal papillae. So these are some peculiar features which are found in the interior of the second part of duodenum, okay, which are important. Then going for the duodenal recess. So recess means some empty space, right, or like pockets. So in the region of the duodenal jejunal junction, small pockets like pouches of the peritoneum will be present, and are they termed as the duodenal recesses. And these can be responsible for the strangulated retroperitoneal hernia. That is, through these pockets, the loop of intestine can herniate into. Okay, and they form the strangulated retroperitoneal hernia. And the 4 major recesses are the superior duodenal recess, inferior duodenal recess, paraduodenal recess, and finally the retroduodenal recess. So then see about the arterial supply. As already mentioned in the before slides, so we have duodenum developing from both the foregut and midgut. So this will receive branches from both the celiac trunk, which is supplying the foregut, and superior mesenteric artery, which is coming from the, which is supplying the midgut. Okay, so if you take this artery, superior pancreatic duodenal artery, this is a branch of gastroduodenal artery, which is again a branch of hepatic artery of the celiac trunk. Okay, and this inferior pancreatic duodenal artery arises from the superior mesenteric artery. These two arteries will further branch out to give anterior and posterior arterial arcades, and these would form the vas recta around the duodenum, and they supply the anterior and the posterior surfaces of the duodenum. Okay, then we have the branches coming from the supraduodenal artery, retroduodenal branches of the gastroduodenal artery, leech branches of the hepatic artery, and branches from the right gastroebloic artery, artery from first jejunal branch of superior mesenteric artery, and this mainly supplies the fourth part of the duodenum. Okay, then the venous drainage of the duodenum. You know, the veins draining will end up in 3 major veins, namely the splenic, superficial epigastric, and portal vein. I'm sorry, this is superior mesenteric. Okay, so one is the splenic vein, superior mesenteric vein, and portal vein. Okay, this is superior mesenteric. Okay, superior mesenteric vein. So splenic, superior mesenteric, and the portal veins. Going for the lymphatic drainage, the lymph draining the duodenum will end up in the pancreatico-duodenal lymph nodes, and the efferents arising from these nodes will drain into the superior mesenteric nodes and finally into the cisterna chyli through the intestinal lymph trunk. Okay, and then nerve supply of the duodenum, the sympathetic nerves will be derived from the T6 to T9 segments of the spinal cord, and the parasympathetic fibers arise from the vagus and supply through the celiac and the superior mesenteric plexus. Okay, let's see an important part, which is the development of duodenum. So this duodenum, as I mentioned before, develops from the terminal part of foregut and cephalic part of the midgut. Okay, and this occurs during the 6th week of the intrauterine life, where the stomach takes orientation, and this duodenum will also loop out. Okay, and changes its position from the midline to the right side, and this is how a C-shaped loop structure is formed. So if you see, the duodenal loop is rotated within the stomach to the right, and this comes and lies on the posterior abdominal wall retroperitoneally along with the developing pancreas. And so this is how this becomes confined to the posterior abdominal wall and becomes a retroperitoneal organ, and this is except for the first part, which is still in contact with the mesentery and remains unattached to the post-abdominal wall, and that's why it's called partly retroperitoneal. And they'll be supplied by the branches of both celiac trunk and the superior mesenteric artery. Okay. So finally, we'll end up with some clinical correlations. So first is the duodenal ulcer. As I've already mentioned, the first part is the one which is most prone for ulceration. Okay, the very first part of the duodenum. And this is because of two reasons. One, it is supplied by the end arteries. Another one is, it will directly receive the acidic chyme, which is coming from the stomach. Okay, so if you take this part, this is called the duodenal cap. Okay, in barium meal radiograph of a normal duodenum, so it will appear as a clear triangular area. Okay, so this will be present as a triangular shadow with well demarcated base and a less distinct apex. So it will have a clear base and a vague apex. Okay, but this, in case of ulceration, if you see, they'll show filling defect, which is these deposits will not be as a uniform shadow. They'll have deformities over here. So the duodenal cap will be found to be deformed in case of duodenal ulceration. And the fleck of barium will be filling the ulcer craters, and that is called the filling defect. And you can find this through the barium meal X-ray. Okay. Going for duodenal injuries, the second part is the safest part, okay, because this is found along the paravertebral gutter and is protected by them. But the third part is most prone to damage by external injury, where it gets smashed between the vertebral column and the anterior abdominal wall during direct violence. And finally, you have duodenal diverticulum. Diverticulum refers to some pouch-like structure. Okay, this is a congenital condition where the duodenum will pouch out like this, okay, through defects in the muscular layer where the arteries and ducts pierce the wall. So in such weak or defective areas, this duodenum will loop out and forms the duodenal diverticulum, and this usually takes place along the medial wall of the duodenum. Okay, so these are the important clinical correlations related to the duodenum. So this was all about duodenum. If as an essay, you have to mention about the microscopic structure and development in detail. Okay, and the second part of duodenum, as I said, is very important, where you can get them as short notes, and you have to mention about the relations, the specific features as I have mentioned, and the microscopic structure along with the interior, where you had the duodenal papillae, plica semicircularis, and the arch. Okay, so hope this lecture was helpful for you guys. Thank you and stay safe.